The light is absolutely dazzling. These are intense experiences.
Well, my biggest fear, of course, is that I should get struck down by altitude sickness again.
Yeah, what we need is to climb a little more.
I've been trying to do a 6-foot by 3-foot painting, and the paint is constantly frozen onto the paper.
I know that it's going to be uncomfortable, and it's going to be tough, and it's going to test me a lot.
Even in our really overcrowded world, there are still places of really intense and extraordinary beauty. You have to go to some extremes, really.
And I don't think we've left quite enough time for this job that I decided to do. I'm not making any promises, even to myself.
With these journeys that I do, you have to open yourself to all possibilities. It's foolish to come with cast iron preconceptions, because nature takes a hand and just will not let you live out the plans that you made sitting in your cozy studio.
I get my inspiration from these wild places. The whole purpose of my work is to describe them and bring them back and show them to people.
Tony Foster is an artist flying into Nepal in search of a bigger subject. His quest has brought him to the town of Lukla in the foothills of Mount Everest. Lukla stands on an ancient Himalayan trade route, but these days it's known as the Sherpa capital and relies for its prosperity on tourists and trekkers making their way towards Everest base camp. From these dusty streets, Tony Foster will attempt to climb as high as possible and accomplish a unique series of paintings. There's a long trek ahead, but just enough time for Tony to cast his eye over the mountains and attempt the first few brushstrokes of this trip.
Looks a little dull at the moment, but and also working rather slowly, I think. But it's a matter of getting your eye in and practicing a bit, and then you hope that finally things improve as you go on.
Just a first quick study, but to succeed on this trip, Tony will have to spend as much time trekking as painting.
We've got a 5-hour hike to go, and we've obviously got to get there before dark, so I've run out of time, but I think with a bit of work I can see how it might turn into a painting. It isn't a painting yet, it's just a few really rough field notes, I suppose, really. At least we've made a start, and that's the important thing. The first paintings are always pretty bad, really, but anyhow, it's all part of the learning process.
Tony won't be travelling alone. Porters will carry food, fuel, tents and sleeping bags in these baskets, the essentials for surviving in the mountains. And there are some companions joining Tony, drawn by a sense of adventure. Kurt Ohms tries out a heavy backpack. Susan Goodwillie will be seeing Everest for the first time. Ang Puri, who knows every trail and peak, will be Tony's Sherpa guide on this trek into the mountains.
To travel and be able to paint what's around you, and I think it's the best career choice you could make.
What's your hopes for this trip then, for yourself?
My hopes for this trip is to make it up to base camp and not get too much altitude sickness.
I know that it's going to be uncomfortable, and it's going to be tough, and it's going to test me a lot, physically and mentally. Wherever you go, there are marvellous things to see and paint. And so, you know, you can't just walk past them and ignore them. There they are, they're wonderful. You know, do something about them.
Try something I've never tried before. It's masking fluid, and you paint that on in the areas that you want to stay white, and then you paint over it. I'm going to try using a stick because I don't really want to destroy one of my brushes, but I will if I have to. Think that's good? Okay. It might be a total failure. This is filthy stuff. I hope it works. But if it doesn't, well, what have we lost? A couple of hours' work. This isn't the precisest stick in the world. We'll just have to wait and see, because now I've got to wait for this to dry, and then I'm going to treat the distant mountain with washes of colour. And try and get that sense of sort of misty colour over snow. It's a bit of a gamble, but anyway, what have we lost? 2 or 3 hours, if it's a waste of time? We'll see. Really the effect I wanted. It looks too... Well, I can only use the word mechanical.
I don't know what else to do.
Bit of a grim sight, this one. Anyway, I'll carry on and try a bit, see what I can do to it. The other alternative, I suppose, might be to put a wash over the whole thing, so it doesn't look quite so stark. It looks too stark, really. Cloud came down just after lunch, and you can't see the mountain at all, so the mountains have disappeared, which didn't really help. Well, but luckily I'd mostly finished with the mountain this morning, so, and I'm going to wash a blue shadow over it, or a blue mist over it, cobalt with a little bit of permanent rose, I think, and I'm hoping that's going to fix it, and if it doesn't, I think we're done for. I think this is a guaranteed 100% failure, and it'll have to just take its place among the great failures of history.
Okay, here goes. The moment of truth.
I suppose the thing about watercolours is that you never know if the thing's going to work or not until often until right at the end. And occasionally I've even spent 6 days working on a painting and then ruined it in the last half a day and just had to not exactly screw it up and throw it away, but just abandon it. So this might be one of those, who knows?
Mists sweep in, and it's time to move on. Tony's final destination is still many days away. Getting everyone there in one piece will be an achievement.
One porter who
had sprained his ankle very badly, and there didn't seem to be any way of him not carrying a big load, even though he got a sprained ankle. And so it seemed to me that we're not in a particular tearing hurry to get it to any particular place. We haven't really got an itinerary. So, you know, why not take it slowly, give me a chance to do a smaller painting on the way, and give everybody a chance to acclimatise a bit.
My paintings get better the more I'm absorbed in the subject and the longer I'm there.
So much contemporary art today is about the artist's inner landscape, but there are some subjects outside the artist which are so enormous and so extraordinary and so awe-inspiring that artists ought to be able to express something about that. You have to put yourself through a certain amount of difficulty and a long trek and spend a certain amount of time doing it, and that seems appropriate to the subject.
I don't think I really have to punish myself in order to make good paintings, but I do have to absorb myself in the place completely.
The previous year, Tony's desire to be there, to absorb himself in his subject, exposed him to serious risk. On that earlier expedition, Tony's search for a bigger subject had brought him to the Himalayas, but high in the mountains, at more than 17,000 feet, he realised he was seriously ill. He simply couldn't go on working at that altitude.
And I always knew this was going to be a rough enterprise, difficult. And I must say that I think I've probably hit the wall. I've started showing signs of acute mountain sickness. Coughing up blood. The ferocious headache that I've had for 5 days now that hasn't gone away. My hands and feet have swollen up so much that I can hardly put my boots on. I've been trying to do a 6-foot by 3-foot painting, and that's been very difficult in itself, in that the paint is constantly frozen onto the paper. So the painting itself, although rescuable, I think, is a sort of piece of heroic wreckage at the moment. So, and I feel pretty rough generally. So all in all, it seems like this is going to have to be where Foster meets his match. A lot of people have failed on Everest, and it looks like I might do the same. But here we are, that's life.
Tony abandoned that first trip to Everest and returned to England. Now, back in Nepal after a year, the first days of trekking take Tony and his companions higher and higher, closer to the snow line, into thinner and thinner air.
Well, my biggest fear, of course, is that I should get struck down by altitude sickness again. Because I had altitude sickness very severely last time at 17,500 feet, I wasn't able to do as much work as I wanted to on a big painting that I was doing there. One of the symptoms of altitude sickness is that your brain swells up, so you're not really thinking as clearly as you should, and not working as well as you should. So I wasn't able to remember what I'd learned and what I'd observed when I was doing that painting. So I thought it would be a very good thing to come back, bring the painting back here, take it back up to my original painting site, and sort of remind myself of what was there, what inspired me in the first place, and do some more work on it.
That big, unfinished painting of the Everest range has travelled thousands of miles back to Nepal. For the final stretch, it's being carried in a metal tube to protect it from the weather.
I felt there was unfinished business, and it was important to me to go back and finish it.
Everything hangs on the weather and the unpredictable effects of thin air at high altitude.
You know, this whole trip is based on the idea that at least I can get up to 14,000 feet. If I can't do that, then I don't know, I would consider it a failure, really.
Tony's team makes it to more than 11,000 feet and the town of Namche Bazaar. It's shrouded in freezing mist, a place to hunker down and acclimatise while the weather closes in.
The Sherpas all said that they didn't expect weather like that at all. They said it's never like this. We've never had snow, 3 feet of snow in the middle of April in Namche Bazaar.
This is the last staging post before Everest, a town which makes its living from selling last-minute supplies, from warm clothing to chocolate bars. Tucked away in a valley, it's a place for killing time and waiting on the weather.
But one thing you learn in the mountains is if you're in a good position and the weather is closing in, then stay where you are, don't start moving about. So we're staying here in this very nice tea house, and that suits me fine for today. That you will stay for a day to acclimatise. Looking at the weather out here, I can't see that when we go up another 800 feet, we're going to expect any kind of pleasant conditions. I think it's going to be pretty rough, really.
Tony finds a corner to finish the watercolour he started on the first day of the trek. He works from pencil notes written onto each painting, reminders of colour, light, shape and detail. This is one of his smaller works, a fragment of what he calls his search for a bigger subject. But to finish that big painting he's brought with him on this trip, he's going to need good weather and a measure of good fortune.
Well, I'm spinning this prayer wheel to give us good grace on our journey.
You have to have fate on your side to do these things. And if there are gods, you have to have them on your side. It felt like the journey was starting off in the proper way.
Tony's journey has been delayed by the heavy fall of snow, unusually severe for a Himalayan spring. He begins to worry that his porters aren't properly equipped for the deep snowdrifts and icy conditions which lie ahead.
Porters usually wear completely unsuitable footwear, just ordinary plimsolls, or flip-flops. First of all, of course, I can't imagine what it's like wading through ice and snow in flip-flops. It must be absolute hellish, I should think. And secondly, of course, it's incredibly dangerous. And so we've decided that we're going to go into Namche this morning and fit the porters out with a pair of boots each. Waiting until it's thawed out. It froze last night, so the snow is very slippery and hard for the porters to walk on. So we're waiting until the snow thaws out a little, or the frost lifts at about 10:30, then we're all setting off for Kum Jong. My painting site is in a bowl in the hill, and that bowl is bound to be full of snow. I should be surprised if it's got anything less than about 3 feet of snow in it. So I think we're going to have a bit of a replan, and we're going to have to think about what exactly our options are when we get there. But anyway, we can't tell until we get there, and we'll see what it's like. But we should be able to see some big mountains, certainly should be able to see Amitabhlan and some big stuff, and hopefully Everest, yeah.
Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
Looks like our gang here. I recognise the laughter. Don't recognise the yaks. Namaste! Yeah, there's the toilet. I remember that distinctly. Leaning at a dangerous angle. Hi. We thought we'd lost everybody. That was a good hike. Very nice. Namaste! I told you I'd come back. Do you remember me, the painter?
Yeah.
I said I'd come back and here I am. So, nice to be here. This is a great place. Of course, you don't know it because you can't see the view, but the view from here is just stupendous. Absolutely stupendous, but you'll have to take my word for it.
Why is there no view, Tony?
Why is there no view? Because it's snowing and we're socked in cloud. And I'm not at all despondent. I've got a fallback plan, which I'll tell you about over lunch.
Tony's planning another small painting, while his companions settle into the relative comfort of a tea house and recover from their brisk ascent to more than 12,000 feet.
It's a beautiful walk, except it was more of a forced march because we followed Shinzi up here.
Oh, Shinzi, yeah.
She was just
flying.
She was flying. I'm going to have to learn a couple key Nepali words. Yeah. Slow down. Time for break.
Outside, the porters dig deep, clearing room for the trekkers' tents.
What are you doing,
Ang Puri?
Yes, sir.
What are you doing?
So we made a camping place. So we have moved the snow.
The weather clears for the first time in days, and Tony gets a glimpse of the view he's travelled thousands of miles to see. On the far horizon, bathed in the light of a Himalayan sunset, Mount Everest.
The light is absolutely dazzling.
The man in his mountain.
I don't think so. I think it's somebody else's. Could be Hillary's. Or Tenzing's.
When the clouds finally parted and gave us that first dazzling view, everything looked so extraordinarily beautiful, I couldn't believe it.
Oh.
Okay. Morning.
Tony, how are you?
Fine, thank you. Slept pretty well last night.
So great.
Do you have any honey? Honey?
There should be a good day's painting ahead for Tony, an opportunity to complete the big unfinished painting. But even as he treks towards the site with a clear view of Everest, there's a problem.
I'm just going to open this up and have a look at it in the landscape. What do you think of the sight, Kurt?
Beautiful.
Pretty amazing, isn't it?
The clear blue skies and heavy covering of snow would normally be a source of inspiration. But not this time. Even as Tony assembles his drawing board, he suspects he won't be doing any painting today. When he unfurls the roll of paper, the problem becomes clear. The heavy snow has covered up large areas of rocky mountainside, which look quite different in the painting he began on his previous trip. Before he can finish the picture, he'll have to wait for much of the snow to melt.
In terms of finishing the painting from what I see in front of me now, because there's much more snow here now than there was last time, this is a hopeless case. It's been sitting in my studio staring balefully at me for a year now, and it's about time it got finished. Because the snow's melting off pretty fast now, isn't it? So if we come back here in, say, 6 days, 7 days, hopefully most of the snow will have gone and I can return to what I got here last year and finish the darn thing.
Unable to finish the big painting, Tony seeks solitude and a view of the wilderness.
All my work actually is it's a celebration of the fact that even in our really overcrowded world, there are still places of really intense and extraordinary beauty, and which are completely untouched by humans. And so to find those places, you have to go to some extremes, really, because anywhere that's reasonably temperate or easy to live in, there are people living there. Most of my paintings show no mark whatsoever of human beings. Occasionally there'll be some tiny little dot somewhere, but mostly I don't have any marks of humans at all.
The Nepalese porters and yak herders are used to working at this altitude. Tony too seems to have acclimatized to the thin air. He's working on a series of smaller paintings when the weather allows.
It's before lunch and the clouds are already forming up, and so I thought I'd better get something down before we have yet another day of sucked in cloud.
How are you feeling being constantly thwarted by the weather?
Well, I'm sort of philosophical about it, really, because I know perfectly well that in mountains you just get what weather you get, and you just have to make the best of it. What's the point in complaining about it? But it is a little frustrating, I must admit.
The team is now working at more than 14,000 feet. Tony's worst fears about altitude sickness are realised when it strikes one of his trekking companions. While Tony has been worrying that he would suffer altitude sickness again, it's the cameraman filming him who suddenly develops the symptoms. Matt Malloy suffers a bout of acute mountain sickness, which can kill if it's not treated quickly.
The problem with altitude sickness is that you feel very tired and you just want to go and lie down and go to sleep, and that's the worst thing you can do because your lungs begin to fill with fluid and you suffocate.
Shortly after filming these pictures, the cameraman makes an urgent descent seeking treatment. While the cameraman recovers at a lower altitude, Tony spends 4 days working on his watercolours.
Normally speaking, I am completely solitary when I paint, and I like to be able to concentrate absolutely on what I'm doing, and any distraction I find quite difficult to cope with. So there have been very few really private, quiet moments to get on with my work as I would like to. Both the paintings I've done in the last 2 days, early on, looked like they were going to be disasters. And I managed to bring them round, not quite sure how, but managed to bring both of them round so that now I think they can be quite reasonable paintings.
You guys back in service? Mr. Cameraman, you back in one piece?
Yes.
Eleven days into Tony's journey, the landscape still doesn't look the way he needs to finish the big painting. The snow has only begun to thaw in the foothills.
I always find in these journeys that really even if the situation seems hopeless, you have to keep on painting because in the end you hit your stride. And the only way you can hit your stride is to keep day after day, practice, 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 practice. And then when you hit your stride, you know it, and you then after that you make no mistakes. Just occasionally you take yourself by surprise, you think, gosh, I'm wasting my time here. And then you look at it a few days later and think, well, actually, that says something about what it was like when I was there and I can remember something about it. And that's the moment you're working towards, really. And the only way to get there, I find, is to practice.
Every day I keep a written diary, all the events of the day, what time I got up, where I went to, what happened, where I painted, what happened while I was making the painting, how the painting's coming on, who's argued with who, who's passed out with altitude, whatever's going on in the day, I note it down in my diary.
Before dawn, Tony decides to embark on a solo mission. While everyone else in the camp sleeps, Tony sets off, determined to find inspiration and a new perspective on the Everest range.
You never get what you think you're going to get. And I've learned that over a long period. And so I suppose, you know, sometimes people expect you to come back with a certain kind of work, but sometimes you can't, and you always do have expectations, you can't help it, but you have to learn that those aren't that important, really. Your expectations are just things that you had before you had the experiences.
I hate to say it, but I think it was up on one of these ridges.
So the important thing is to learn from your journey, really.
Yeah, what we need is to climb a little more. See that light coming through there now? It's almost pink. It's fantastic.
Sky is the quickest thing to paint in many ways. It's a big area very often and you can paint it quite quickly. But it's also the most likely to go wrong. And if it goes horribly wrong, then your painting's ruined, and it's far better if that happens early on rather than, you know, when you've already spent several days on it. I mean, the worst sky for a watercolorist is just plain blue, because it's almost impossible to paint a flat blue sky without some streaks in it somewhere. Once that's done, of course, that sets the tone really for the rest of the painting. You can see how the painting is going to develop, the color in the landscape and so on is going to develop. In mountains, often what you need, because you can often see very, very long distances, you need quite a few blues. The further away something is, the slightly bluer it looks.
I realised I haven't got that peak anywhere near high enough, so I'm going to put it up. You scratch the surface off the paper, and that's that. So this is Lhotse.
Shar, Lhotse. Yes, this is Lhotse, and this is Shar means in the east.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
And what else?
Excellent.
Stronger shadows in the foreground. Stronger shadows. Okay, there we are, done.
Angpuri is not just a skilled Sherpa guide, as Tony discovers.
Well, I found out that Angpuri was a painter the first year when he sat next to me and studied very closely what I was doing. And so I then gave him painting equipment so that he could get on and make his Buddhist paintings, sitting next to me doing my paintings of his landscape. It made we work very happily together, really, but both in completely different traditions.
What are you making a picture of, Angpuri?
I'll just do the Buddha, sir.
The paintings that Angpuri was making of the Buddhist iconography, they conform very strictly to a set of geometric and symbolic rules. And so that's obviously incredibly important in the making of those particular sort of temple paintings. It's impossible to avoid the spiritual aspect of the lives of the Nepali people. Their entire lives are inculcated with their Buddhist faith. You know, I do think that life has a spiritual dimension. Spending long periods of time in these extraordinarily beautiful places is in itself a spiritual experience, really. Their Buddhist faith is very important to them, obviously, and much of the landscape is seen through that filter, in a way. If you see all the prayer flags that they tie onto trees and bridges, and it's all about that is an expression of their faith, which is very important to them. And it'd be a very insensitive person who didn't actually take that on board as they were travelling through that country.
Spring sunshine is melting the snow on the lower slopes of the Everest range, revealing much of the rocky landscape. Tony has one last opportunity to complete the big unfinished painting. His team sets off on the trail, counting on good weather.
I suppose I would just hope for really clear weather and for the landscape to look something like what it was like when I left it last time. And, of course, for me to be clever enough to finish my painting in the way I want it to be finished and not mess it up. You know, it would be pretty terrible if I messed it up at this stage. Sometimes I've worked on a watercolour for 2 or 3 weeks and messed it up in the last half day. All I've got so far is what, 6, 7 small paintings. And I would have dearly liked to have done at least one other major piece of work. So philosophically or spiritually or psychologically, it feels like the end of it, really, if I can only get that damn thing finished.
More than 2 weeks into this trip, the conditions are finally right for Tony to complete his picture of Everest. But time is short.
Physically, it is a struggle sometimes, no doubt about that. I'm struggling more against my own limitations. That's my struggle. It's like people saying they conquered Everest. Well, nobody ever conquers Everest. You might manage to scramble to the top of it if you're lucky, but that doesn't mean you conquered it. And I don't think of this as being a competition between me and the landscape. I'm simply trying to exist in it. Albeit sometimes in very difficult conditions, in order to say what I want to say about it.
Tony knows he has just one full day left to complete his painting. The weather is clear, the landscape matches what he already has on paper, but conditions can change quickly and without warning.
Here, let me get this once you deal with your painting.
Yeah, all the way up.
You paint it last, but looking good.
Okay.
We'll leave you to your work.
Thank you very much.
Adios.
Adios. Have a good day.
Come on, you guys.
I don't think we'd left quite enough time for this job that I decided to do. But, and I really rather underestimated, I think, just how much, you know, white paper I arrived with. Somehow in my mind, I had this idea that this thing was kind of 2/3 finished. Because when you look at it, it's not even half finished yet, because, you know, this whole area here, all this, and all this, there's nothing on it. I often wish I could paint in a much more loose and gestural way and just sum up the entire landscape in a few brush strokes, but I just can't. I wish I could.
We'll just have to see.
I can't. I'm not making any promises. Even to myself.
His painting encompasses not just Everest, but the peaks and valleys which surround it. It's been a long, grueling journey to reach this point. But Tony believes you can only capture the essence of this landscape by being here.
In a way, the more you do in the field, the more authority the work has. The less you do in the field, you know, the more you do it from your imagination, the less authority it has. So I like my paintings to have as much authority as possible. I'm trying to bring together all the things that you notice and all the things that you smell, you hear, you feel. All those things play a part in the work. The Himalayan snow, for example, is the element which is going to reduce Mount Everest to dust in the end, if you wait long enough. And it's just that it's that light, bright, white stuff which is going to reduce that extraordinary rock to dust. Have a little piece of that in the painting, albeit melted into water, is sort of symbolic of the fact that there are eons of time here, and you know, my paintings, us, you know, we'll all be gone. There are these extraordinary and awe-inspiring and wonderful, magnificent places which are literally breathtaking, particularly when you get very high. They're not only metaphorically but literally breathtaking, it seems to me that is something that artists ought to have something to say about. Now, this is a difficult way to make art, there's no question about that, but on the other hand, you know, it is a way of placing oneself in the world and commenting on it. Weather's closing in, and we were just in the last 2 hours of this painting anyway, and I thought I'd better do some notes quick before it starts to rain.
Thick cloud has obscured Tony's view, and time has almost run out. He makes detailed notes on the bare white spaces which are still unpainted. For now, this ambitious work will remain unfinished.
Because, as far as the painting's concerned, I think I can do the rest of it back in the studio fairly adequately now. Is that, this is where they say it's a wrap.
Back in his studio in the southwest of England, Tony's getting down to the business of finishing his series of paintings, one by one.
When you bring it back to the studio, you think about it much more in terms of actually making a painting work. They often take a lot of sort of serious, quiet contemplation back in the studio. On site, you're trying to get down your impressions. When you bring it back to the studio, you're thinking about how the painting works in terms of your eye tracking to the focal point and in terms of the foreground coming forward and the background going back. And making all those adjustments are very important. It's a very important part of picture making.
Work on this series of paintings began on that first ill-fated expedition. Undaunted, he went back to climb and paint higher than ever before.
This little painting here is the highest painting I've ever done in my life. Painted at 17,800 feet on a little hummock, really, called Kalapata. And here is it. This is Everest here, and that's probably the closest view I will ever have of Everest. The extraordinary nature of Everest looming up behind and dominating absolutely everything. And there's always, of course, this wind blowing on Everest. There's always a huge wind there, and it's always blowing stuff off the top and snow blowing across. These are intense experiences when you're there, and when you look at what you bring back and start work on it, it brings back to you the feelings that you had when you were there, and the sounds and the sights, obviously the sights, but the sounds, the smells, the encounters, all those things come back to you as you work, and so they are sort of literally souvenirs, you know, from the French idea of the souvenir, to remember something. And they are remembrances of time spent in a particular place.
Tony collects objects which form part of the finished work.
It's to give people a sense of the reality of the experience. In other words, it's a bit like, you know, when I was a kid, when I went to Paris, I came back with matchboxes with French written on them to prove that I'd been there. Well, this rock proves that I've been to Everest, because that is actually a piece of Everest. Wherever you go in Nepal, prayer flags are flying from absolutely everywhere, and this is a little piece of one, and the map with the little red cross showing where exactly this painting was done, and then the diary underneath, what I call the diary. This is actually an extract from my written diaries, but on this one, for example, it simply says, from Tengboche, looking 40 degrees northeast. Now that's important to me, so that people know exactly the direction I was looking in. To Everest. This was the painting that I did. I got up at 5 a.m. and I started this painting in the early morning light, and I painted until about midday.
This is a souvenir from the big painting Tony has been striving to finish, Melted Snow from the Slopes of Everest.
The snow that I was collecting has ended up in this little bottle, and here it is, of course, melted. The top has been sealed with my own personal seal to stop it evaporating and sealing the cork up. And that will appear in the mount underneath the painting, but inside the frame.
Tony's big painting of the Everest range is all but complete. It's a roll of paper which has travelled from England to Nepal and back again twice. Now, all that remains is to apply a few final brush strokes.
Thank you. And that, I think, no, that was the last, absolute last brushstroke on this painting, which has taken me, not continuously, but it's been 14 months, I suppose, since the beginning to the end, and the damn thing is now finished. And I must say it's an enormous sense of relief. There are some places in the world which are so extraordinary and of symbolic importance in a way to us, and we should look after them and preserve them and just, you know, be thankful that they still exist.